West Hartford has a long history of women who were social activists. When Edna Bertel was 18, she climbed Lafayette's statue in the nation's capital to advocate for women's right to vote. Dr. Hilda Crosby Standish headed one of the first birth control clinics at Hartford Hospital in 1935, soon closed in 1940. Standish did not practice medicine, but became an advocate in the 1950s, teaching some of the first sex ed classes to junior high students in West Hartford. Today's Planned Parenthood in West Hartford is named after her. Mims Butterworth is a peace activist, political organizer, and trailblazer who protested McCarthyism in West Hartford living rooms in the 1950s. Her 1965 case before the Supreme Court changed our representation to one person, one vote in the State House. She was among many women who for years protested for peace in West Hartford Center every Saturday at noon. In the late 1960s, West Hartford resident Charlotte Katowski turned her energy to opposing the new highway, Route 291, chairing the Committee to Save the Reservoir. She held countless rallies, gathered thousands of signatures on petitions, stirred anti-highway sentiment, and advocated mass transit alternatives. When the plan was ended in 1973, the new Environmental Protection Agency gave Katowski an award for blocking the construction of this highway through West Hartford's reservoir. B'nai Tikva Shalom Rabbi Deborah Cantor protested the treatment of women in Israel at the Wailing Wall. In 2013, she and dozens of women were arrested and jailed for trying to pray at that location. Passionate current-day advocate West Hartford Senator Beth Bai has legislated to get BPA out of children's products, supported early childhood education, voted for gay marriage, helped to pass stricter gun safety laws, and helped advocacy groups fight the MDC to protect our water. Both of West Hartford's public high schools actively teach activism to their students. In 2015, student activists fought to successfully get rid of the Native American mascots, which had been in use for about 60 years. All of these West Hartford activists willingly stood up for equality, justice, and freedom, and sacrificed time and energy in their personal lives for the greater good. Hundreds of people from all walks of life in West Hartford are expected to take part in the Women's March on Washington, organized in Connecticut by West Hartford's Sarah Raskin, this January 21st at our nation's capital. Many more will march in New York City, Boston, and right here in Hartford. All these activists have helped establish a culture in the town which is fertile ground for more activism, an activism that will not quit.
Hi and welcome. I'm Sima Shapiro, your host of the new activism series, West Hartford Activists. We've just heard a great introduction by town historian Tracy Wilson, and we're here to talk to four activists who range in age from 16 to 75 about their reasons for being activists, about their desire to be activists moving forward through the march, and what they hope for the future in terms of their own activism and in terms of their hopes for the country. Sarai Hertz-Velazquez is a high schooler who was raised by two powerful feminists who taught her to always consider other narratives beyond the one she knows. She is an intern at Planned Parenthood and co-leader of her feminist coalition at school. She hopes to pursue a career in social justice and never wants to stop being an activist. Jillian Gilchrest is a mother of two who has been an advocate and activist since college. Jillian's activism is primarily focused on improving the lives of women in Connecticut, particularly advocating for anti-violent public policies and protecting access to reproductive choice. Beth Kerrigan lives with her wife Jody and their twin teenage sons. Beth and Jody were the lead plaintiffs in the same-sex marriage case, Kerrigan versus the state of Connecticut, which was successfully argued by GLAAD in 2008. Supreme Court Justice Richard Prommer wrote the majority decision for the Kerrigan case and married Beth and Jody on the one-year anniversary of marriage equality in Connecticut. Beth is currently a member of the town council. Carolyn Gable-Brett has been a feminist and LGBT activist since the 1970s. She established the Connecticut chapter of NARAL, the National Abortion Rights Action League, and was on the faculty of UConn School of Social Work, where she coordinated a project on violence against women. She was a co-founder and co-manager of the very popular Reader's Feast, Hartford's feminist progressive bookstore cafe, for 12 years. Among the many groups she's been involved with over the years include Connecticut's Love Makes a Family, fighting for full marriage equality in Connecticut. Carolyn lives with her partner of over 30 years. They have three grown children and three granddaughters, so welcome all.
Thank you.
So very briefly, tell me, how long have you been an activist? What is your reason for being an activist? Do you think this is your calling? And what do you hope to accomplish by doing this work?
So for me, being an activist means so many different things, but especially because both my parents are activists themselves, and I have sort of come from a long line of activism. My abuelita, my dad's mom, immigrated from Mexico when she was a teenager, and since then she has been incredibly involved with a variety of political issues. And likewise, my mom's mom has always brought my mom and her sisters to marches in DC or in New York, and now I have continued to go with her and with my mom and both my parents to different protests and to calling parties, whether it's for Planned Parenthood or senators, just getting really involved. And they've always taught me to be an active participant in my learning and in my life. So not just to sit back and let things happen, but to be an advocate and to make things change if I think that they should change. So I've basically been an activist for my whole life. A lot of it has been my choice, as it is now with being a leader of the co-leader of the Feminist Coalition, and participating in a variety of conferences regarding human rights or reproductive justice. But a lot of it also is just because of the family I was born into. And also a lot of different aspects of myself allow me to be an activist. So I'm bilingual and can speak both English and Spanish. So that has allowed me to participate in a variety of programs and conferences and interact with people from all over the world that, had I not been a bilingual, female-identifying feminist, I might not be able to do that. So, for instance, I volunteer at the Hillcrest Area Neighborhood Outreach Center, where I tutor immigrant families and the children, and also do translating. And that's just one of the many examples of how I can sort of bring all of my different aspects of my life into one. And I also like to do work in my school and in my town while also connecting it to larger parts of my community. So I like to do different projects throughout school. This summer I was actually able to put in gender-neutral bathrooms in my high school with help from the administration and other students. So,
for me, you know, my first way into activism, I was a sophomore at the University of Connecticut when 9/11 took place. And so that was really the first time I started paying attention to the world outside myself. And friends who I had had cordial relationships with all of a sudden were calling for war and supportive of war. There were attacks on Muslim students, and I just was very confused by everything around me and wanted to learn more and get engaged. And so I went to my first march in Hartford. Being a UConn student, I had never ventured off the campus of stores, so it was my first trip to Hartford. I called my parents, and they told me not to do it, and that if I got arrested, they weren't coming to get me. But I went for it anyway, and when the police did show up, I did grab my friend, and we were out of there. But that was kind of my first moment of activism. And at the same time, I was taking my first women's studies class. And it really just was this semester that changed everything for me. I became immediately passionate about women's studies. And I've always been comfortable speaking publicly. And I recognize that other people are not. And so I don't know if it's a calling, but I knew that I had to use my voice and my ability to speak to support the issues I care about. and in particular, that's violence against women. I was excited to learn that there were sexual assault crisis centers. I hadn't known that going into college, and when I discovered those, I committed my life to volunteering at a sexual assault crisis center and to raising awareness about violence against women. And so sometimes it's not the easiest thing to be an advocate on. Sometimes friends are like, oh my gosh, is she talking about that again? Sometimes family members are, oh gosh, do you really have to post that on Facebook and talk about human trafficking or domestic violence? But I feel like by people knowing me in my personal life and that I'm a mom with two kids, that I'm just like, you know, just like you, but we can have these conversations, that's what's important. And so I'm committed to continuing to move the needle. And I think, unfortunately, in light of this election, for me, more than ever, it shows that we still need to be having these conversations because we have a long way to go to get the gender equity and to make this a very safe place for women and men.
Beth?
Thank you for hosting this, by the way. I think this is going to be really valuable, so I appreciate that. My first activist, where I did action when I felt something was unjust, I was 16 years old. I was racing motocross at the time, Bridgehampton, West Hampton, and I went to Islip Speedway to race. I was a member of the American Motorcycle Association, so I went to register, and they said, sorry, you can't race, you're a girl. And I thought that they were joking, because I had never raced at Islip Speedway, and they had never hosted a motocross race before. And so I made some jokes, and they said, no, seriously, you need a note from your doctor saying that you're not pregnant in order to race. And I thought to myself, I mean, as I look back now, I think, geez, my challenges would have been so great if at 16 I was pregnant. My problems would have been so much bigger than racing a motorcycle. But I left that like, oh my goodness, you know, all the guys that I raced with every Sunday were out there racing, and I wasn't for one reason, because of my gender. So one of the other women that I raced with and I went, we went to a lawyer, and we sued Islip Speedway to race. We won that case. They said, sure, you can race. We'll put up a poster and we'll say, women, welcome. Unfortunately, they never had another race. In terms of a calling, I'm one of five children, and I am the only one that's actually been involved actively, that sees injustice and says, I need to do something about that. So I do think that there's a big calling, a part of my makeup, you know, whether it's my chemistry, my biology, but I am called to do that. Now, unlike Carolyn and Jillian, my career hasn't been, I'm in the insurance business, which is probably one of the least activist industries you can be in, but when I see an injustice, I always step forward. And recently, you know, in West Hartford, we had this MDC where they took control of the water and they negotiated with Niagara deep discounts that the residents were paying for, no protection against the drought, and Save Our Water came together, and I was a spokesperson for them. So I do think that a part of it is an individual who has the courage to want, when you're batting against the norm, you want to do boy things. I have more opportunity to make a statement. In terms of the same-sex marriage case, or in terms of feeling isolated, when I go to a march down in D.C., you know, all the gay lesbian marches, they're so empowering, you feel great, you know, wow, I could change the world, there's so many of us. But during the same-sex marriage case, I felt very isolated with my own family, because neither of my parents wanted to talk about this. Or my siblings. So I think when you're being crowd, you feel empowered, and when you're sort of by yourself and you hear, you know, enough, we don't want to hear you, you know, just sit down and be quiet, it's isolating.
Carolyn?
Well, that's interesting, and I'm representing the end of the panel. So I am, as we said, 75, and I represent sort of a different experience of having started my life. I got married after college and I had three children, and I did sort of the very traditional kind of thing, but that was sort of right on the cusp of the women's movement. And that was sort of my experience, that I started out in the women's movement and I identify as a lesbian feminist. So that was really sort of a defining kind of thing that we had in the old days, what were called CR groups. Now, I don't even know if you know.
Absolutely.
You remember those,
I'm 61.
Beth.
I know that.
Anyway, the CR groups were sort of a way of first exploring our own personal experience and then uniting us sort of into a coalition and broader networks. And I think my evolution and sort of experience as an activist has really followed that path, where I really learned to work in coalition and to work with other people to create social change. And I think that, you know, my passion was sort of, and my interest in the beginning of my process was really around reproductive freedom. And that was where I put a lot of my energy. And I felt like that was an issue that really cut across everything. That if you don't, as a woman, have the basic ability to control your body and your childbearing aspects of your body, that you really are limited in the rest of your life. So that was a really critical point. And we were so restricted. So when I started out back in the 60s, abortion was not legal. So now I think of, you know, younger women, and that's taken for granted, whereas back when I started, that was a really big fight. And of course, January 22nd is the anniversary of Roe v. Wade, and an important marker for us, because that said across the country, women would have that choice. Now, it's interesting that has been under attack. And it's one of the things that I think, you know, sometimes you sort of look back and say, have things really changed? How much change did we create? But I think if anybody listened to Obama's speech last night, his farewell speech, he talked about, in respect mainly to racism, that we have come a long way, but it takes, we have a long way to go. So it's not that you can rest, you know, on what has happened and what changes you have created, but your efforts to speak out, resist, and to move forward. And for me, that's been really critical. So that's sort of the path of being an activist for me, is to resist, to speak out, and be present, and be a global citizen.
I'm struck by the fact that all of you have voices, and you use your voices, and it is your voices that give you credence and allow your activism to flourish. Would you agree?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Let's set our sights on the march very briefly. I'm curious about your activism in going into the march. Is it being reawakened? Do you feel as if this is just the next step in the women's movement? How do you look at this in a timeline?
Well, it is interesting because I'm the mother of, I have two sons and a daughter, all of whom have wonderful politics. And my daughter is going to march with me, but she has a daughter. I have three granddaughters, and our granddaughter, who's 8, is going to march with us. And we're marching in New York City, and we're marching with the Lady Parts League. So that sort of, you know, trying to add some humor to what is a very serious issue, obviously. I feel like we have, you know, we're at a point in our history where we're sort of going back, like Obama was talking about. You know, with racism, I think, you know, you take a few steps forward and then you have to reorganize and fight again. And that's where we are, clearly, with the reaction. And a lot of it is reaction to the policies that have come down.
Beth, briefly, what are your feelings about the march and your activism and your intent in going?
Well, I'll be marching down D.C. with Jody, my wife, and our twin boys who are 15, even though it's called a Women's March. I keep telling them they need to be aware. Right. I was so crushed. I worked the polls right here in Town Hall the day of the election. I had my white suffragette suit on. We were going to break the glass ceiling. This was our moment to shine. Finally, we've done it. The most qualified person. So I was crushed. I was devastated. It was like 9/11. And the next day, I had to go to Morley Does the Red Wagon with the food, you know, for the food pantry. And moms were coming up. Talk about being reawakened. Mm-hmm. These women who aren't typically activists, what can I do? How can I get involved? I need to do something. And that's why, you know, on Facebook, when Sarah Raskin, you know, I immediately got on Facebook and she was organizing this through the New York chapter, there was only one place to be, and that's part of that march, because we cannot go backwards. We thought we were going to be taking another big step forward. We haven't even gone as far as we need to go, and we're already feeling we're slipping backwards. So yeah. I think this is just going to galvanize so many women who, quite frankly, unfortunately, kind of took it for granted. They slid, you know, we're marching along. We're in scary territory.
And Jillian, the question for you would be about social media. I know that you're really active on social media, and it is one of the biggest differences about this march. Can you speak briefly about that and your role in that?
Sure, and there's two pieces to that. To build off what Beth was just saying, I too was having folks via social media who I've known since high school or college, who never posted or liked any of my political posts, following them and responding and posting on their own Facebook pages for the first time political things. And so it kind of is this awakening of my generation. It feels like there have been people in my generation fighting this fight, so I don't want it to seem as though there haven't been. But folks who aren't traditionally involved are getting involved. And those same moms, I'm a mom of two young kids, were coming up to me knowing what I do. And so I'm actually heading to the march with activists that I've known for years through my activism work, but also with moms who I've built new relationships with who I think feel comfortable going because they know me. I'm a bridge to this new world. The other piece about social media as an organizing tool has just been tremendous. And the fact that I've been able to connect this group of organizers from Connecticut, we are connected with the national group who's organizing this march. We are connected with advocates from across the country. And on a daily basis, multiple times a day, we are talking about the logistics of the march and what needs to get done. It's just such a fascinating and fantastic organizing tool.
We have 5 buses going out of West Hartford to the march.
Mm-hmm. I know that.
That's fabulous.
It's incredible.
Yeah.
Sarai, really quickly, your thoughts about the march?
So I have been also in shock after, like, post-election, and I wanted to put my energy somewhere, and I was thinking of different ways to do it. I did a couple of things in the community, but my mom and I are going to the march in D.C. Together, and we may or may not meet family members, if that's even possible, by the time we get there. But I am also hoping to do, like, a Facebook Live or an Instagram Live via the march, so those who aren't necessarily in, even if you are there, just to sort of experience something that I hope is going to be a historic moment in history. And I know I was really active on, like, Facebook, especially when there had been things with the pipeline, when people were Facebook Living that protest. So I hope to be involved with that regarding social.
So one more question as a sweep around. What is your thought about social media now? It's an incredible vehicle for this. And I'm harping on it, but I think it has completely set the tone for a completely differing experience. Do you have thoughts about this?
Well, we were talking about that a little earlier, and we were saying how the difference in what's required for organizing. As an activist, we had to work harder back in my day, you know, of contacting people, of networking, of pulling people together, of building coalitions. And I think now it can just happen like that, you know, as where, and I, along with many other people, obviously use the networking that is available to us through social media, and it's incredible. So it's a new tool that we're using, but we're using it, everyone's using it, and the organizing is different and faster. But I think still the work has to be done, and the networking and the coalition building has to happen.
So Beth and Jillian, really quickly, do you feel like the march is intended as an anti-Trump march, or do you think it's intended for inclusiveness or a vehicle for which to make disparate groups find their glue, or none of the above?
Trump is not alone. There are many, many individuals that voted for him, so I wouldn't isolate, say, Trump. What he represents is so vulgar. If a woman or a black individual said anything, just one of the things that he said, he would not have been a candidate. So the fact that this individual, because he's wealthy, because he does reality TV, because he's brass, was able to get elected, I think that it is a march about what our values are, which is about inclusiveness, about together we are stronger, mm-hmm. not about dividing the Mexicans and the immigrants and the disabled and the lesbians. I think it is about what they stand for. Everyone that supported Trump, yeah, I do.
Jillian?
Yeah, what's been pleasantly surprising is that in the aftermath of his election, you know, the folks coming to the table to organize this march are coming because they're interested in gun sense. They want better gun policy. Or they're coming to the table because they're concerned about reproductive choice, or they're coming to the table because of the comments that were made about sexual violence and the knowledge that we have a long way to go there, LGBTQ rights, about racism. And so all of these different groups are coming together to speak about what we want in our society. And that's what I think the march is about. The march is also about, where do we go on the 21st? It's purposely the day after that inauguration. It's the first day of his, I don't want to say reign, but his reign. And so what are we going to do going forward to ensure that the society we all want is where we go? And so I think it's a rallying cry, and it is a moment to come together and not be divided.
And I think it's really a challenge to our democracy. I mean, that's really, in essence, I think we would all believe that that's why it's critical that we work together, because this is really a challenge to our democracy.
Anybody else for their final thoughts about the march?
I think that the election has done a lot of things, but one of the main things it's done is separate the country kind of in two different pieces. And I feel like the march, not being an anti-Trump or a pro-anything, just as a inclusive, like Beth was saying, we are together, we stand together, event where people connect and where we all are basically saying that we are aware of what's going on and we're going to change it because we believe that we have to, and just sort of like an all in this together feeling. And I'm really excited.
I'm excited, too. I want to thank all of you for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you so much to the viewer for watching us today. This is the first of a three-part series on activism in West Hartford. Our second part will be the march and what happens as an aftermath of the march. We will be discussing with these lovely women about their own activism, what their sense of the march is, what their experience was, what they hope for the future, and what their next move is, both as individualists and in their groups. I'm Sima Shapiro, your host and producer of Activism in West Hartford. Thank you so much for joining us. And until next time, I hope you take care.
We're walking for women. We're walking for girls. We're walking for peace. All over. For truth.